Women's football has grown faster than ever before, but we are aware that there still exists a gender data gap, a mismatch in the amount of research and quality of research between men's and women's football. And so to support the female players' health, performance and well-being, we need science that keeps pace with the game. That is certainly the target of the FIFA Female Health Project. So together with Sports Medicine Journal, FIFA have released a special open access collection. And currently there are 7 open access papers that are connecting research and applied practice in women's football. And in this video, I'm going to walk you through each of those articles in turn, explaining what the research has found and what it means for practitioners working in the women's game. I'm Jo Clubb, a founder and sports science consultant at Global Performance Insights, providing sports science consultancy support to teams, sports tech companies, practitioners and athletes all around the world. So now let's dive straight into the FIFA Female Health Project in the Sports Medicine Journal. So here then we have the FIFA Female Health Project in Sports Medicine Journal, and I'll put a link to this webpage below. And you can scroll down and see we've got 2 fantastic researchers who have been the editors of this edition, Professor Charlie Pedler and Dr. Kat Ockham-Krieger. And here now then we have our 7 articles. And it's worth mentioning every single one of these are open access. So certainly take a look at the full texts, download them, read them, chuck them into ChatGPT or a similar AI-driven research tool to help you question them and analyze them even further. Now I will take you through each of them in turn. I'm actually going to mix up the order a little bit from how it's listed here, just in what I think is perhaps a little bit more of a natural order for us talking through it today. So I'll start with this paper then, From Growth to Greatness, a leading article on the professionalization, health and performance challenges in women's football. And this paper is written by Dawn Scott, who I'm sure is familiar to many of you, Rick Lovell and Belinda Wilson. And this is really setting the stage by addressing the rapid professionalization of women's football. Describes how we've seen huge growth in the game, in domestic leagues, the expansion of the Women's Champions League, record-breaking international tournaments like the FIFA Women's World Cups. But of course, with that growth comes higher demand on players, more matches, tighter schedules, international travel, and increased training expectations. And so there's this key tension in women's football that this paper highlights, that whilst the game has professionalized on the surface, they write about how the supporting infrastructure, so the sports science, the sports medicine, recovery, facilities, and welfare system hasn't necessarily caught up with that rapid expansion. And that can be linked to risks of injury, overload, and burnout in the game. They, of course, highlight that the women's game isn't just a scaled down version of the men's, has its own unique context, growth and challenges, which may also, of course, require tailored solutions. And it's because of that then that the authors emphasize the importance of collaboration between researchers, practitioners and governing bodies to translate findings into actionable strategies. And again, as I said, it's setting the scene for this special issue in which the following articles provide an overview of our current understanding and how to support female players in areas such as the menstrual cycle tracking, sleep, recovery, nutrition, pregnancy and postpartum care, and that this issue aims to spark further innovation and collaboration, laying the groundwork for the future of the women's game and tailored critically to the needs of female athletes. Next up then, I'll jump to this one, benchmarking the physical performance qualities in women's football, a systematic review and meta-analysis across the performance scale. And I'll admit, yes, I am a very proud co-author on this paper, along with Rick and Dawn, but the superstars of this paper that did a lot of the heavy lifting, definitely Heidi Compton, who previously, prior to marriage, was Heidi Thornton, a name you may recognise from some older fantastic data visualisation papers, along with Zil Shushan, who I'm hoping you recognise the name from his fantastic work on sub-maximal fitness testing. For this paper then, we wanted to dive into what information, what data was available in the literature on physical performance testing in the women's game. So we pulled together the data from almost 19,000 players across 288 studies to try and create normative benchmarks for physical qualities that matter in football. And we've tried to summarize our findings here in this graphical abstract and give you an overview. So we looked at these 7 physical qualities of cardiorespiratory fitness through acceleration, sprint, change of direction, maximal velocity, lower limb strength, and lower limb power. As you can imagine, by taking all the research that was available, we had many different challenges, including how to classify different tiers. We took this participation classification framework from McKay and colleagues and just adapted it to be more relevant to the women's game. And then also broke the different capacities down into different testing types, as well as different protocols and technologies that would be used. In terms of comparing across tiers, we found that sprinting ability, lower limb power, and intermittent aerobic capacities seem to be the qualities that most differentiated players across these tiers of competition. And critically as well, Heidi converted the data set into an interactive, shiny dashboard. So you can access that through the key points here. You can see the shiny app. So completely open access still. It gives you the detail of our research paper, including just how many studies and observations went into it. But critically here is when we can start to look at different test types and get normative information. So for example, if I look into cardiorespiratory fitness and, for example, select the test, so this is the 30-15 intermittent field test, and my outcome measure is the velocity at the end of the test. And we can see that there were 11 studies from women's football that went into this. And we also get an idea here across those different tier groups, and you can go into the paper and have a look at what that actually means from a participation level and see how your players might compare to the relevant tier group that they are in. And we can see that this really was one of the measures that did seem to distinguish, particularly between tier 2, which, if I remember correctly, are more of our semi-professional training, perhaps no more than 3 times a week group on average across all these studies, which we can hover to see the specific study that is referenced here. We can see a greater average in that velocity of the intermittent field test in tiers 3 and then 4 and 5 compared to tier 2. So hopefully a very worthwhile resource. As I mentioned, completely open access. Anyone collecting some physical testing data with their female athletes can come in here and compare how their athletes compare to these normative values from the literature so far. Next up then, we have pregnant pitches, navigating football before and during pregnancy, led by Amal Hassan and this group of authors. These are our world leaders on the topic, in my opinion, of pregnancy and then return to play postpartum. So if this is something you or your athletes are facing, then these are the people whose research you definitely want to be looking up. And we've got 2 papers in this issue from this group. Firstly, this one about pregnancy, and then the next one about return to play postpartum. So here they're kind of debunking the traditional assumption that pregnancy meant to withdraw from training and competition altogether. They say that with medical oversight and appropriate adaptations, many women can safely continue playing and training during pregnancy, and that in fact, that level of physical activity may have physical and psychological benefits for both mother and baby. Now, of course, there are risks, and the authors state the need for individualized assessment, but that their key message is that pregnancy shouldn't automatically exclude athletes from the game. So, of course, they go into a hell of a lot more information, and here we've got a really nice figure that they've put together summarizing the safety precautions for pregnant athletes. And then I really love this figure as well in terms of thinking about the needs to haves, the nice to haves, some potential marginal gains, but then also critically things to avoid. And this really is a summary anyone with a pregnant female athlete can make use of. And as I said, real expert group have pulled this together. Linked to that, then we have this next article on considering return to play postpartum in the footballer, again, by this same expert authorship group here on this topic. So they explore the physiological and musculoskeletal changes that occur postpartum. So that's things like ligament laxity, pelvic floor recovery, as well as changes in body composition, as well as then the broader psychological and social factors that shape an athlete's return. Much like any rehab, any return from injury, then the authors here argue that return from postpartum should not have fixed timeframes. It should be seen as a continuum and individualized based on the process that the individual in front of you is going through and how they are responding to it. Again, then we've got a really detailed amount of information in here that any practitioner supporting an athlete returning after postpartum should certainly look into. And again, they've really nicely summarized their recommendations here in this figure into needs to have, nice to have, potential marginal gains, and things to avoid in this situation. Now we shift our focus to recovery in female footballers. And firstly, then we have this broad review by world leaders on the topic of athletic recovery, on physical and mental recovery for female footballers. As is always the case with our athletes, recovery is critical, especially in this context, given the congested match schedule and increasing training loads and demands in the women's game, as well as, of course, returning the physical status back to baseline. There is the importance of the mental load carried by athletes. And in the context of women's football, many of the players are potentially balancing careers still at certain levels. And they're also potentially have slightly different demands in terms of family and now an increased exposure in the media. So again, a ton of amazing information included in this open access article. Like is often the case with recovery, we look at the topic through the lens of this pyramid, because we certainly have our more foundational building blocks like sleep, mental recovery, nutrition and hydration, all the way up to those trendy fad-based recovery methods. But of course, this emphasizes the importance of having that holistic approach to recovery, particularly here trying to address both the body and the mind, the physical and the mental recovery in our athletes. That paper links massively, of course, then to this one, which dives specifically into sleep in terms of recovery, but also focusing on what evidence is currently available in terms of sleep behavior in women's football. So this review led by Shona Howson shows that sleep in the female athletes can be influenced by hormonal fluctuations across the menstrual cycle. So many athletes report poorer sleep quality during the luteal phase, and that could have knock-on effects to recovery, mood and readiness. But also we have the similar challenges to sleep as we would in the men's game. In any kind of football competition, they're facing late night matches, travel schedules and potentially early training sessions. And I think that's reflected nicely then in this figure, where they've combined both the football specific factors, the context of the sport that influences sleep behaviors. Then we have our female specific factors, as well as our perhaps individualized other non-sporting or non-gender specific factors as well. So I think this is a nice overview of all the various factors that contribute to sleep disturbance, considering both sport and gender specific or more generic considerations. And again, we have so much valuable information here in this open access text. Just scrolling down, because there's a pretty nice summary at the bottom here. And once again, it highlights that in recovery, regardless of gender, we are dealing with the need for an individualized approach. That is then coupled with the female specific considerations. And again, although there are patterns in the menstrual cycle, and much more research is needed, of course, on that topic, and much more higher quality research, that also shows a great deal of individual variability, reinforces that whole combination then of looking at your individual athletes. Finally then, and I thought I'd come to this paper last because it really is about the future of women's football and talking about using our past learnings across performance, medicine and health. And Rick and Kat, who have authored this paper, have pulled these together, these recommendations, into the acronym of Women for Women's Football. So you can see here in this figure, this summary for women as an acronym. So they're talking about worldwide representation and that we do have an issue even within the research that exists in the women's game in terms of reflecting the diversity across the globe. And even we have a bias within the data that is already collected according to race and different various backgrounds within female football. They talk about the importance of open science as a means for accelerating the research that is collected and the impact of this research. And similarly, then the methodological approach, because it is hard to research some of these topics in women's sport and women's football. And so some of the research that has gone before is with not high quality methodology. So we need to not just improve the quantity of the research, but also the quality of the research. That then connects to evidence-based practice. So ensuring from an applied practitioner's perspective that the research is answering the questions that they have and in a way that researchers and practitioners can work together to really use the research to have an impact on what is actually happening on the ground. And then finally, N for nurturing talent. So this focus on longer term research and alongside that longer term then athlete development, which has not really existed in the women's game. This paper then nicely summarizes how historically research in women's football has been underrepresented, underfunded, and often limited in its methods. And so through this paper, they're calling for greater collaboration around the world, open data sharing, more rigorous study design, and just a stronger pipeline of female researchers and practitioners. And ultimately, all of that should help with the support of our female footballers. So those are the 7 studies from the FIFA Female Health Project special issue in sports medicine. So we talked about benchmarking physical qualities, recovery, sleep, pregnancy, motherhood, as well as the future of women's football. So this really is such a comprehensive resource for anyone working in health and performance with female footballers. And of course, best of all, it is open access. So please do take a look with the link below the video and go and have a look at the papers in full. I hope you found this video useful. If you did, please like and subscribe to make sure you don't miss out on another Sports Science Insights video coming very soon.